If the mountains were you high, and oh, how far I'd scale the valleys, if you grace the other side. Oh, how long have I chased rivers from lowly seas to where they rise against the rush of grace descending from the source of its supply. As in the highlands and the heartache, you're neither more or less inclined. I would search and stop at nothing. You're just not that hard to find. Oh, I would praise you on the mountain. I would praise you when the mountains in my way. You're the summer where my feet are. So I would praise you the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same. Whoa.
The same, no less. excited to worship with all of you here in the building, and thank you for joining us online as well. I'd like to read a passage from Psalm 95 to you this morning. It says, "Come, let us shout joyfully to the Lord, shout triumphantly to the rock of our salvation. Let us enter his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout triumphantly to him in song. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. The depths of the earth are in his hand, and the mountain peaks are his. The sea is his, he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the sheep under his care. We are his, we belong to him, and we can step right into that freedom this morning. And I pray that you would do that with me. Would you stand and let us worship?
Deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. Darkest night, you can light it up. talking to anybody. But is anyone going through struggles? Is anyone up against a wall? We just saw in that last song that strongholds are going to crumble. But sometimes it just feels like you're against that wall and you just have a little hammer and chisel and you're trying to come up with your own way and making your own designs and decisions. But there's so many places in the Bible that tell us not to lean on our own understanding and to cast our cares on Him. There's even a spot in Proverbs, I think, that says, even if the problem's your fault, sometimes we get mad at God. Like, why'd you allow this? You know, hey, if you just give it to me, I'll show you the solution. And sometimes what we forget is to look back and see how good He's already been. And remember that He's still good, and He's gonna be good. So as we go into this next song, any walls that you're up against, any struggles that you are holding on to or you just can't get through, just lift them up to God and remember how good He's been and remember that He's going to do it again.
This is my faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
The scripture tells us not to forget his blessings. He's never failed us, and he won't fail us. I appreciate Josh sharing that word, his impression from the Lord. That was exactly what I was sensing at the same time. The one thing I've learned after following the Lord for a while is we can try a lot of things on our own strength. But one prayer to heaven can change everything. One ask of God can change everything, where years of working has produced nothing. Years of good ideas and trying to fix this and fix that, but that one reach out to heaven changes everything. Josh asked if you were struggling this morning. I'm just gonna ask you if you're struggling this morning and to raise your hand this morning if that's a struggle for you right now. Don't be ashamed. Raise your hand. That's why we're together. If that's a struggle, you need God to move. You've been crying out. You've been trying to fix it yourself, but you need God to show up. Raise your hand. I want to pray for you this morning. Father, we just lift our hands to heaven with that one request that can change our world. All these folks that raise their hands, Lord, I'm sure they've poured their heart out to you already, but we join together now. Lord, we ask you to move in these situations like no one can move, like we can never do, because you move those mountains, Lord. And we do expect that you'll move more mountains in our life, because we've already seen it. We believe in you. We trust you. We placed our life, our future, our present, our past, all in your hands. And now we are trusting you, Lord, to take those requests, which the scripture says are like sweet incense going up before your throne. They're pleasing to you. We send those prayers up now, Lord, asking you to do something in the lives of everyone that raised their hands. We thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. This is the morning that we join together and go to the Lord's table for communion. So you should have received a little cup at your seat. So go ahead and get that ready. If you're at home, make sure you've got some type of bread or juice available as well. So go ahead and take a moment and just get the bread out and make sure the juice is ready to go. So, and then I'm going to read you a passage of scripture, and then we're going to join together, okay? You know, every Sunday we meet for a reason. Jesus. Jesus is the center of our lives. Our life apart as individuals, but also our life together as his people. Jesus is the center. As we come to communion table, the Lord's table, as we celebrate the Eucharist, we always need to remember that he is the center. If he is not the center of your life, that is something you need to address before we take the bread and the cup in just a minute. Jesus is the center. I love this verse out of Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. The writer says, long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And we celebrate that Jesus this morning, who has changed our lives forever. We commemorate his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his return as we celebrate communion. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11, 23, 26, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We're also given some instructions a few verses later. Let a person examine himself. Then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Let us examine ourselves. Is Jesus the center of our lives? Or our distractions, or hobbies, or other pursuits? Jesus is the one that saved us. He is the Son of God. In the Book of Common Prayer, I love this passage from it. It says, examine your lives and conduct by the rule of God's commandments, that you may perceive where you have offended and what you have done or left undone, whether in thought, word, or deed. And acknowledge your sins before Almighty God with full purpose of amendment of life, being ready to make restitution for all injuries and wrongs done by you to others, and also being ready to forgive those who have offended you as Jesus has forgiven you. Father, we just take this moment now. We come before you in a quiet moment, and we, Lord, ask you to search our hearts, examine us, speak to us through your Spirit. What have we left undone? What should we have done? What did we do that you didn't tell us to do, that you've commanded us against? How have we offended? How have we hurt others? This morning, we ask you to show us. Lord, how have we not made you first in our lives? How have we put something before you? Show us this morning before we eat the bread, drink from the cup. We just thank you for that. Thank you that your Holy Spirit works within us. Let's take a moment. You ask the Lord, you speak to him this morning. And if he brings things to mind, then ask him to forgive you, and he will. Lord, we ask that you forgive us for all those things that have been brought to mind. And we thank you, according to Scripture, that you do forgive us when we confess. And Lord, we also forgive those who have offended us, just as you have forgiven us. Lord, give us a heart to make it right. with others. Give us a mercy and compassion for others, just like you've had for us. Make us your people. We are, but make us more your people in the way we conduct ourselves, in the way we think, in the way we act. We know that you're working in us through your Spirit. Continue to sanctify us and conform us to the image of Jesus. We just thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and get ready to take the elements together. If you just hold the bread in your hand, we're going to break it together to remember that the body of Jesus was broken on the cross in our place for us, for our sins, so we would not bear the wrath of God. Jesus took it upon himself. Father, we thank you for the broken body of Jesus given for us. Let's take the bread together. Not only did Jesus take the wrath of God, our punishment upon himself, he reconciled us to God through the forgiveness of sins. The scripture says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission or forgiveness of sins. Jesus shed his life blood on the cross. And when he did that, something fundamentally changes in our life when we place our trust in him. We are reconciled to our Creator, and we are brought into the kingdom of God and become the children of God. Not just creatures, not just creation, but children and family. Jesus did that for us by shedding his blood. Let's take the cup together. Father, we thank you for the broken body of Jesus, for the shed blood of Jesus. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for obeying the Father who loves us so much that he sent you to die on the cross in our place. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for making all this so real to us and transforming us step by step, sometimes just baby steps, into the likeness of Jesus. Thank you. Continue to do that good work in all of us. We look forward to your return, Jesus, when you put everything right and we get to spend all eternity with you. What a glorious celebration it will be. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Just as he's given to us, now it's our chance to give back to him in our tithes and offerings. So I just want to thank you so much for your continued giving to our church so we can continue to do the things that God has called us to do. Thank you for all your donations to the Foster Families Navigation and Resource Center. And I know some more folks brought some more in today. Because of your faithful giving, we were also able to help cover the cost of their website design as well. So thank you so much for that. If you have any questions about fostering, please see Sarah after church today. Just catch her. Now, as a reminder, there are several ways you can give, and they're going to be listed on the screen. So I want to read some instructions and promises of God. 2 Corinthians 9:7-8 says, you must each decide in your heart how much to give. Don't give reluctantly in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. And God will generously provide all you need, then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. That's instructions, but it's a great promise. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you out of all that you've already given to us. We don't own it. You do. We just manage it. So help us manage it well as we give to you and use it in various aspects of our life. Let it use what you have given us for the kingdom. Lord, today I pray that you would bless the gift and the giver. Multiply the gift to its use and multiply it back to the giver, Lord, according to your promise and your word. We just thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Let's take a look at the announcements this morning.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Life. My name is Sarah, and whether you're in the room with us today or joining us online, thanks so much for spending part of your weekend with us. If you're new with us today, we want to tell you that we are so glad you're here and want you to feel at home. For us, church is so much more than just a Sunday service. We want to get to know you and for you to find your place at New Life. The best way to connect with us is to fill out our digital Connect card, which you can find in the Facebook live feed or on our New Life app, and we will get in touch with you soon. Once again, we are so excited that you're here. we want to take a few minutes to share some things that are coming up at New Life for you and your family. So check this out. Thank you for bringing in your clothing items for Foster Families Navigation and Resource Center. We were able to donate bags of shirts, pants, socks, pajamas, and more to help stock their foster exchange closet. Thanks again for making a difference, New Life. Our membership information meeting is happening today after service. If you signed up, or even if you didn't and you're interested in learning more about New Life, hang out in the sanctuary after service ends and we'll get started shortly. The swag store will be open today after service. We still have some of our new logo apparel, like hats, t-shirts, crew necks, as well as our One Makes a Difference t-shirt to promote our 2021 theme. If you're in person today, stop by the cart in the lobby after service to check it out. Or you can head to the Connect tab of our New Life app to make your purchase.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you. Is it beginning to look a lot like spring? Does that excite you inside? I'm kind of excited about the whole thing. So I have a picture to show you this morning as we start this. You can see that's Europe and Africa, South America. This is my ancestry according to Ancestry DNA. Or is that what it's called? DNA at ancestry.com. That's it. And you can see, let me kind of get to you. This is Scotland up here. Anybody know anything about? According to my ancestry, I'm 51% Scottish. I always knew kilts looked appealing to me for some reason. And, you know, for anyone that, you know, has Scottish roots, you have Sean Connery, a national treasure for sure. So Scotland is my biggest, 51%. England, right down here, 29%. Little Ireland over here, I have green eyes. Do you know the majority of the people in Ireland and Scotland have green eyes? Like 70-something percent more than any other country in the world. So I have very special eyes, so take a look at them after service today. Even with the mask is up, you can still see my eyes. Norway, that was a surprise. Norway, 6%. And then Germany kind of stuff, about 3%, which I guess is my last name. That's all I got from Germany, I think, was my last name. So that's my ancestry, and you have an ancestry that's unique too. All your ethnic backgrounds, your family, your history, and you know what? God likes it. God likes this. God made it this way, where all of us have this diverse background with different cultures and foods. We all like the food part, don't we? Languages, maybe I'm hard with languages, but all of those things. I mean, God made it that way. And then my family came over here and we settled in a couple spots. My dad's family and my mom's family. And we migrated north now, living in Michigan. So we're starting something different. So everybody has the story in their family and you have your own unique ancestry. And God designed it to be that way. And how do we know that? Because it says in the Bible. Acts 17, 26 and 27 said, and he, God, made from one man, Adam, every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. This is Paul talking to the Greeks, a Jew talking to the Greeks about how God laid everything out in the universe. And he did it that way for a reason, so we might reach out to him and find him. I don't know how it all works, but that is his desire. Common origin, one. We come from one, but diverse cultures. And God planned it that way in our nation. Many cultures have come together to form something completely different that we call America. And America in itself is almost like an ethnicity. If we go somewhere else in the world, there's a good chance someone is going to know that you're American by the way you act. Why is it this way? Well, throughout this sermon series, we've been going back to Genesis chapter 1, since this is called Honoring the Image, and we learned from Genesis chapter 1 that we're created in the image of God. And we're going to keep going back to that each week throughout the series. In the beginning of creation, we find some answers. Today's message is called Diversity is a Gift of God. Would you say that with me? Diversity is a gift of God. It's a gift of God, and it's never going to go away. And I'm going to show you that at the end. It's never going to go away. Ever. Genesis 1:26 says, then God said, let us, say that with me, let us. That's very important. Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. God said, let us. Who's he talking to? Himself. Let us. We believe God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us. Three in one is what we call the Trinity. One God, three persons, three in one. God is one. Why would God create all this diversity? Because in his own nature, there's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If there was just Father, there couldn't be, because there's no Son. We were designed to be different, to have relationship, to be able to love, because that is in the nature of God. That's why we see the diversity everywhere, because in God himself, there's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The early church fathers called it perichoresis. I have a little picture here to show you. You'll notice it's kind of like one heart shape, but you'll see like three in there. Perichoresis is this idea of a dance, of a circle dance, perimeter and choresis, choreography. The idea of a dance between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this dance is completely harmonious and unified, but yet it's diverse. This is the picture of God's heart. And this is why he creates the way he does. We are created in his image. All of us, perfect harmony between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. One agenda, each giving honor to the other. This is the nature of God. Let us, God said, create people who would dance together in creative harmony. The Scots and the Irish and the Norwegians and the English and the Germans and the other 16,500 ethnic groups in the world. And none of those are ever going to go away, because God designed them all, and they're all made in his image. Isn't that powerful? Diversity that we see in all the peoples of the world reflects the nature of God. We see his creativity spilling out everywhere. Music, art, architecture, dress, food, thinking, the ways to approach the world. God's intention is that this great dance between all the cultures reflects the great dance between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It would flow in harmony. Let us make man. But look at the next part of this verse. I want you to see what I'm gonna show you, because it's right in the first chapter of Genesis. Genesis 1:27, we just said let us. So then it says, so God created man in what? So it went from us to what? This is the Trinity buried in the Old Testament that wasn't quite understood yet until Jesus made it known fully. 1 and 3. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them and blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth, make it diverse, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and heavens and over every living thing that moves on the ground. Let us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God, three persons, made in his image, one unity. The Christian faith is the answer to the world's issue with race and diversity and everything else. Jesus, the Sunday school answer is, why is that? And the answer is, Jesus is the absolutely the right answer. Jesus, Jesus, it's the answer. Jesus is the answer to diversity and unity. We see it in the Trinity. Jesus brings it to us. We see something else here. He creates male and females, diversity of gender. The Bible doesn't stereotype male and female. Let me say that again. That's not really a topic in the 7-part series, but I'm dealing with this on Wednesday night at a class. The Bible does not stereotype men and women. It doesn't say women cook and men don't. It doesn't say that anywhere. Okay, I just want everybody to know that. We've invented that. Now, the Bible does create biological gender, and I can't have babies, nor do I want to. And that is what it is, because that's the way God designed it. It does establish God's biological design for humanity so that man and a woman can multiply by having children that will create diversity, that will fill the earth, and more people can join in this great dance at the end of the age. In that diversity of male and female, there is unity. This is the consistent pattern of the Bible. Diversity, but yet unity. Not uniformity. Not uniformity. That's not unity. Uniformity means everybody's exactly the same. Many times we want everyone to be exactly like me. You want everybody to be exactly like you. That's why my wife looked at me once. She said, "You just want me to be like you." And the thought came to my mind and said, no, I really don't want that at all. Because all of us want to eliminate all conflict and everybody was just like us, we just all get along. But that is not God's design. God's design is we'd be unified in our diversity, but you don't erase the unity and you don't erase the diversity. And that means we all have to work at it. And working at it makes us more like Jesus. And many times we want to reject one or the other. Genesis 2:24, male and female, there is unity. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh, diverse but united. We call that marriage. Unity and diversity in that marriage, because that is the nature of God. Marriage reflects the nature of God. You see that in the New Testament. See that in the Old Testament. And that nature has been printed all over creation. And that's why many Christians are concerned, rightfully so, about the notion of gender and marriage. Because we see it going back to the very nature of God himself. God placed the man and the woman in a garden, paradise, gave them what they needed to do the mission. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth, go all over, all places, fill the earth with the images of God. Because that's what we are. Civilize the world. They were supposed to rule over it. Create culture, music, art, food, architecture, poetry, invention. All this was for the glory of God. All this is for the glory of God. The earth was meant to sing the praises of God every day. And life would be a great dance. A worship service to God, just like our words, but with our hands and our feet. Fill the earth. People would live next to the sea and they would fish and develop a unique culture. People would live in the mountains, learn to ski and thrive in the cold like the Norwegians. I didn't get very much Norwegian blood in me, I think, because I don't like the cold. Different people will develop different cultures, different ways of living life, but all singing God's praise. But we haven't cooperated with God very well, have we? Have we? In chapter 3, Adam and Eve say no to God. He tells them what to do and they say no, so they rebel against God, and that's what we call sin. Rebellion against God. Sin is ignoring God, his ways and his words. Sin is turning away from the source of our life to ourselves because we know better than God. Have you ever known better than God? Go ahead, raise your hand. Everyone raise your hand. All of us have known better than God. Because when we went out there in the world and we decided we'd do it on our own and we never bothered to consult him, that's a statement that we know better than God. When we're making big life decisions and we never ask God what he thinks, that means we've made ourselves God. Because we think we know better and we don't need to consult him. And none of us know better than God. But we're always second guessing God, thinking that we can find a way better than his way. And we can't. And when we sin and we turn to ourselves because we know better, there's disharmony with God and each other. The broken relationship with God always means broken relationships with each other. Chapter 4 of Genesis, one brother kills another brother because of jealous anger. Does that still happen, you think? Yes. Brothers and sisters and families and tribes and nations feud, fight, kill. Brothers enslaving their brothers. We have that experience in our country. Sisters even destroying the fruit of their womb. We have that in our country. God warned the first people, if you go on your own way, it's going to be nothing but bad. And you know what they did? They went on their own way anyway. And it's been nothing but bad. God told them exactly the truth. They even refused to fill the earth up. They refused to go out everywhere. Sinful people, here's the thing, this should not be a surprise to anybody. Listen to this. Sinful people make sinful plans. Would you agree with that? Sinful people make what? And they design sinful systems. Why is that a surprise to anyone? Sinful people make sinful things. That's what they do, because they're sinners. We all do that. One of the sinful systems that they built was called the Tower Building, or the Tower of Babel. Genesis 11:4, God said, go out. In Genesis 11:4, they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. See, they were thinking unity, but what weren't they thinking? Diversity. They didn't want to go next to the seas and in the mountains. They want to stay put and make a name for who? Themselves. They were put on earth to make a name for God. We're put on earth to make a name for God, not for ourselves. They were thinking unity, not diversity, thinking self, not God. But God said, fill the earth, not stay put. See, anytime we get our eyes off God, get your eyes off God plus your eyes on self, what do you get? Next slide. There you go. Eyes off God plus eyes on self equals what? Sin. God took action so they would scatter just like he commanded. Do you think sin is still a problem? Do you think rebellion against God is still a problem? Do you still think people want to make a name for themselves and don't really care about making a name for God? Do you think people still step on other people to make their way in the world? Do you think that people still design governments and organizations and laws that can hurt others and does not honor the image of God? Sure they do. All the time, every day. Because we're sinners. We are saints that sin, but we still sin. And we design sinful things. As long as there is sin and evil in the world, all of these questions will always be answered yes. No exceptions, no denying it. We see it all over there, in you, and especially right here in me. Let's just think about ourselves in the United States of America, the country that we love so much. The Declaration of Independence, one of the greatest documents ever conceived and written by humans. This is what it says. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Just go down a few sentences. And it says, talking about the King of England, he has excited domestic insurrections among us and has endeavored to bring on the inhabitants of our frontiers the merciless Indian savages, whose known rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. Who lived here first? Who? Who brought who on what? In this wonderful document we call the Declaration of Independence, a few sentences down from that wonderful phrase about rights, it's already calling the indigenous people, the natives, what? Merciless Indian savages. Do you see how such a wonderful document that we all treasure, that's one of the greatest things that we've ever done in one of the greatest countries that could ever even be conceived, can still at its very founding mess it up from day one? Because we're sinners and we sin and we are not perfect, and there will never be such a thing until Jesus comes back. And we can invent new systems to eliminate our imperfection, and guess what will happen? We will still be imperfect. Ethnicity is not appreciated and labeled. And that's not really consistent with the verses before that, the sentences before that. You know that we are the people of the United States, right? We the people, the preamble. Well, you know, black people were left enslaved in the Constitution. Now, I know there was a provision in there that eliminated the slave trade. That's good, okay? And our system was such that it allowed freedom to come, because we have a good system. But the system is a human system, and all human systems are filled with sin. I don't care if I make it or you make it, and that's the way it is. I'm not beating us up. I'm just stating the truth. Broken humanity, this stuff is everywhere in the world. We're fallible individuals, and we have to be humble about that, and we have to listen to what other people have to say so we can learn about the things that we do not see. You do not see things that are right in front of your face, because you have not lived the life of someone else. You do not know what they went through. You do not know their struggles. And even if they tell you, you still cannot fully understand it because they lived it out. You cannot understand what I have been through. You, unless you've been a pastor like me, you have no concept of what it is to be a pastor. None. And I can explain it to you all day long, and you will not understand the pressures and pains, challenges, and the blessings of being a pastor because you have not been one. You don't know. And that's the way it is with all of us in our stories. Nobody knows the trouble we've seen. I mean, think about it. We all tried and messed it up, haven't we? We said the wrong thing. We've done the wrong thing. That's why 1 Corinthians 11:28 that we just read, let a person examine himself, then so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Let's examine ourselves. In that chapter of 1 Corinthians, if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it is about economic issues there because the poor are being left out of the communion meal, right in the church. Jesus wants us to be different than the world. While we are citizens of this country, residents of this world, part of the human family, created in the image of God, we are something more. We are followers of Jesus that is different. Jesus is that unifying person that harmonizes our diversity. Galatians 3:28 says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ. I'm still a man. She's still a woman. Our unity in Christ did not erase the diversity. But what it does, it brings us together around the one that can bring the whole world together, the one that created the world. It's Jesus. Jesus is the solution to all these issues. He does not eliminate diversity, but brings everything together in unity under his kingship. Jesus is creating a new people. Revelation 5:9-10, and they sang a new song. This is a vision of heaven. And they sang a new song saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nations, ethnos, ethnicity, every place out there. And you have made them a kingdom and priests and to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Jesus came to redeem all of creation, to buy them back from sin, death, and the devil, and to create a beautiful dance of diversity that honors God. That is what eternity will look like. That is what heaven will look like. Look around. It's not all going to be vanilla. And who wants that? Rebecca McLaughlin, in her book, Confronting Christianity, said, Christianity is the most diverse, multi-ethnic, and multicultural movement in all history. And that's absolutely true and provable. Christianity spans everywhere, and it doesn't erase the diversity of the individual cultures. Christianity is unique. Jesus is the answer. And we have a part to play in that, but let's remember, we're pushing back against evil. There is evil. There is an active enemy that does not want a dance of diversity before the feet of the king. Wants to throw everything into chaos. John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, Jesus said. The thief, the devil, evil. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I hope you understand that the thief, the devil, is still trying to kill, steal, destroy, and divide and create disharmony. Sin and evil and the devil are deceivers. Look what Jesus says about the devil. John 8:44, when he, the devil, lies, he speaks out of his own character. For he is a liar and the father of lies. You think that's pretty clear? So what we have to do, here's the thing about a lie is palatable because it has some truth in it. It's like medicine with a little cherry flavor added, but the medicine will kill you. And that's what the devil puts out. So we have to view everything in light of the scripture and the character and counsel of God. We need to consult God's heart when we deal with diversity in our country. Of course, our country has struggled with ethnically based issues. In our pursuit of economic gain and political power, we created the concept of race. Humans created the concept of race. There is no biological basis for it whatsoever. We created it to use it to justify, to put other people down. There are ethnicities, there are nationalities, there are tribes and peoples. The Bible talks about all that. But the idea of race, that somehow you are different because of the color of your skin. Wow. That's not even logical. But here's what I learned about the devil. He's not logical. God is logical. God is rational. God is reasonable. The devil just makes things up to throw people off. And when we smell around and go, that doesn't make any sense. That just doesn't make any sense. That's because the devil is at work deceiving people. We are descended from the same people, all created in the image of God. Jesus came to redeem people from every tribe and nation. God loves the tribes and families and ethnic groups, 16,500 of the world, because each brings something different to the table. This is why there's a biblical command to go fill the earth and another biblical command that says, go make disciples of all nations. Because Jesus is the only one that can redeem all those 16,500 ethnicities for the kingdom. Only Jesus can. He's the only one that can unite us. The world would have us think differently. All Christians, as Christians, we need to model unity and diversity. The church is supposed to find answers to actually represent those answers to the world. And we're damaged. The church is damaged because the church has bought into some lies about race. I mean, the church in America supported slavery. How could that be? I mean, when you just think about it, you go, how could that be? But we did. Because we put something else before God. We put our self-interest and our economic well-being. Some of us did. White people did. Now, you think about it. I put you my ancestry up there, right? Normally, when I fill little things out of what your background is, guess what my option is? White. Just Wonder Bread. That's all I got. Just squashy Wonder Bread with no nutritional value in it whatsoever. Someone didn't stick some in there. And so what does that do? I'm just white. Or you're just black. There's something deeper behind all of this stuff. We have been designed in the image of God and put with peoples, with different cultures and different ways of thinking. And I can tell you, the more you surround yourself with some different thinking people, the better person you will be. Because you will not be deceived. Here's what I've learned in the last few years in the church. If I've got other people around me that think differently than me, that have a different background, they will keep me from being deceived. Because if I only think the way I think, I can't see all the blind spots out here. But when they come in and they go, well, have you ever thought about that? And I went, no. I've never thought about that at all. That's why we have teams of leaders. We have elders, plural. We have financial board members, plural. Deacons, plural. Why? Because everybody sees something different. And it's the same thing with ethnically. The best thing that ever happens is Christianity's penetrated about 10,000 of those ethnic groups. And when we bring all those people in the church, we see even the scripture differently than we saw it before because they bring something different to the table. It's awesome. But yet, as Martin Luther King says in 1960, April 17th, I think it is one of the tragedies of our nation, one of the shameful tragedies that 11 o'clock on Sunday morning is the most segregated hour. It still is. That was 60 years ago. How can we change that? Here's how we can change it. Romans 15:7, accept one another. Then just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God, accept one another. Not just on the surface level, but accept one another doesn't mean you agree, but accept one another means you love each other deeply and you seek to understand one another and bring each other together in relationship and friendship so there can be this dance of diversity before the feet of God. In our day, we hear words like privilege. And people, I remember hearing the word underprivilege. Do you remember that word? Underprivilege means what? Under privilege. I didn't know that till a week ago, and God said, think about that word, underprivilege. We don't use that much anymore. Underprivilege means there's privilege and there's underprivilege. I'm just saying, when people use these terms, ask them, what do you mean by that? Get to know our brothers and sisters' hearts and their approach to the issues. What are they thinking? Don't pay attention to the news because the news doesn't know what you guys are thinking because they didn't ask you, did they? Black Lives Matter. Of course Black Lives Matter, but the reason people say Black Lives Matter is because they didn't feel like Black Lives Mattered. Black Lives Matter is just black people that want to say Black Lives Matter. It's also an organization. Did you know it's two things? One is not necessarily the other. Ask people what they believe. Ask people of color about what they believe. Ask what they think. Ask what they've experienced. I think it will change the way you think. I think you'll see something completely different. It has me. Listen to the heart of another. Our hearts are tenderized. Our preconceived ideas, our unconscious bias begin to melt away when we actually hear the heart of another human being that is different than us. Galatians 6:2 says, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. You can't bear anyone's burden unless you know what the burden is. And the only way to know what the burden is get to know people that are different than us in the body. Blue Lives Matter, you've heard that. We all know in theory, I mean, not in our heads, that a law enforcement officer's job is not easy. Would you agree with that? But if you ask a cop to tell you their story, because otherwise you're just living in theory land. And you just believe what someone else told you. We have cops here. You can ask them their story. We have a chaplain to cops in the front row, Pastor Jeff. He'll set you up. We hear all these volatile worlds, cancel culture, social justice, critical race theory, and we go. Because we have this preconceived idea what that means. You can have a theory, but that doesn't mean anyone practices the way the theory is written. You gotta research and you gotta ask people what they're thinking. And when they start telling you what they think, don't start preaching to them that they ought not to think it. Because as soon as you do that, the relationship and the friendship is done. Because you are disrespecting them. You're not honoring them as being created in the image of God. You don't have to agree. Because if you just agree because somebody, then you're still not respecting them as the image of God. Proverbs 18:13, spouting off before listening to the facts is both shameful and foolish. Let's make sure we're listening. We have to be careful that we don't push people away. You know the verse, I've said it a lot over the last year, James 1, 19 and 20. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. We have to listen to each other's heart. I'm gonna share, put a bosh up here from Sister Frances over here that she gave me, I asked if I could use it. I know some of these issues are not easy, but this is what she said. If it is hard for you to bring it out, then it is time to bring it up. Let me say that again. If it is hard for you to bring it out, then it is time to bring it up. Especially in the body, because we're the body of Christ, because we're supposed to be the models to everyone else out in the world. If we haven't figured it out, how can we tell anyone else? There's a quote that I came across this last week. If Walmart is diverse, then your church can be diverse. Been to Walmart? I think it's fairly diverse, so we can be diverse too. We're just around the block from Walmart. God wants us to cultivate redeemed diversity in our midst, just like this picture that I had up earlier. According to Psalm 8, we're all been crowned with glory and honor. And this is the way it's gonna be in the end. Look at this verse in Revelation, last verse. Revelation 21, 22. John's having this heavenly vision, and this is what he sees right at the end. And I saw no temple in the city. For this is the new creation, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb, Jesus. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it, and its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. They, the people, will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations. Of all the ethnic people, 16,500 and probably the ones that went before that no longer exist, they will bring the honor and glory God crowned them with that they have spent all these thousands of years developing that now has been redeemed by Jesus, and they are going to bring it into the kingdom. And I want you to think about the celebration that will happen. Think about the marriage supper of the Lamb. Do you think it's just going to be turkey? It is going to be so many food and music and celebration and dancing and dress. It is going to be something that everyone will be talking about for all eternity. And that is what we are supposed to be tasting right now on earth in the church. But are we? We need to work toward this. I'm going to have our elders come up and get ready to pray for you now. I'm going to pray over you. If this is a struggle for you, I'd encourage you to come up. Let the elders pray with you this morning. If you got any kind of sickness in your life, come, let the elders anoint you with oil. If they have that with them today, I don't know. And they'll pray with you one way or the other. This is a big deal. The church needs to pursue this. You need to pursue this. I need to pursue this. Father, we just thank you so much this morning for this opportunity to get a little glimpse of the future of this great diverse dance. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for these people. Let us hear your word and put it into practice. And Lord, we pray for those that don't know you. They need to get in on this. Maybe they're listening today here in this building or at home online. Right now, we pray for them that you would touch their hearts and souls by the Holy Spirit, and you would draw them to you into a relationship, that they would understand they need you desperately because we're all sinners. They would believe in what you did on the cross. You went on the cross and died in our place, buried, resurrected, ascended, coming back again, and they would confess you as Lord. And all that means, Lord, and you know this, is you're the master and we follow you. Help them see that through your Spirit now. Do that in their soul. We just thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to have you put your hands out this morning. I'm going to ask the Lord to bless you. Once again, the altar will be available for prayer. This is the scripture I'd like to read over you today, is Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 and 19, Paul's prayer for the church in Ephesus. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Can you say in Jesus' name? Amen. Great to worship with you this morning. Altar will be available for just a few minutes for prayer. So God bless you. Have a wonderful day. If you're watching from home, bless you. Enjoy the day.
Oh,